David, we're back.
We are back. Happy Friday morning.
Yeah. This will be Ham Radio Now, episode 299, this close to 300. I don't know what I'm going to do for 300. I'm not going to be here. I'll probably be down in Orlando. I'm going to title this HamNauguration.
Awesome. You're so good at those.
No, that's terrible. And you have a guest to introduce us to.
Yeah, actually, today we're going to talk to Jeff Dahn. Jeff Dahn is KB3ZUK, and Jeff was on the ground in Washington, D.C. for inauguration and some of the events that followed that. I'm looking forward to talking to him about it. Thanks for joining us today, Jeff.
Oh, thanks for having me. I really appreciate the opportunity.
Yeah, thanks for coming on Ham Radio Now. We found you as a result of this announcement that came on the ARRL's website. You're listed right up there at the top. Your participation in the Parks on the Air got you into this, and we'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute. But there is something else here that I wanted to get to before we talk about that, if I can find it. Oh, there it is. Sure. David, a few episodes ago, we had talked about the idea that people involved in emergency services, employees of hospitals and things like that, were able to use amateur radio legally when not too long ago it was prohibited for them to be able to do that as a result of a new rule that was incorporated, I'm going to say 2 years ago now, but that's a rough guess. And this is that rule. It's part of 97113. Prohibited transmissions, and what we're looking at here is this section I, and I'll read it for the audio audience. A station licensee or station control operator may participate on behalf of an employer. That's an unusual thing in ham radio. Participate on behalf of an employer in an emergency preparedness or disaster readiness test or drill, limited to the duration and scope of such test or drill, I'm speaking in my best governmentese, and operational testing immediately prior to such test or drill. Test or drills that are not government-sponsored are limited to a total time of 1 hour a week. So if this is something that is happening through your emergency management, there's apparently no limit. And then twice a year, they can be conducted for a total of 72 hours. So you can do 3 days worth of EmComm. So I guess what the deal is if you work for emergency management or a hospital, a lot of the people you work with, they've tended to become hams more often now than they used to. Mm-hmm. And they can legally use ham radio for these drills. Now, they could legally use ham radio in an actual emergency because it's an emergency.
Right. You
know, kind of all bets are off then. But now they can test. And that was just one of the things that kind of fell through the cracks, as more and more emergency management people were getting involved in ham radio and getting licenses, and eyebrows were raised at the prospect of them participating in the drills. No one had a problem with them in the actual emergency. But in the drills, people were saying, you work for them. You really can't play with the radio unless it's an emergency. So now they can. That's been the case for a little while. And I was kind of surprised that you are not really familiar with that change. It's reminding you that you were.
Well, no, I hadn't seen that before. And I'm definitely going to print it out and bring it. We have an Aries meeting tomorrow morning. I'm going to bring it out and put it on the table and talk about it a little bit. We are definitely seeing more and more hospital employees getting their tickets, but sometimes they participate and sometimes they don't, and it's good to know that they could.
Quite legal. All right, so that's the little business at hand. Oh, yeah, of course, there's always one more piece of business at hand, and that is pointing back to Arvin. Arvin is our mascot here at Ham Radio Now. He is the chief financial officer. He is responsible for filling the coffers. If you enjoy the programs, get something out of them, whatever they're worth to you. And Somebody sent me an email recently saying that he had some serious medical bills and was apologizing for not sending something. And I sent an email back and said, listen, Ham Radio Now should be really very close to the bottom of your priority list for where you spend money. But if you can, if you know, got the rent paid and the kids' college fund has, you know, you made the contribution to that. And there's a little bit left over. The cool ways to do it are the Patreon. $1 a month, $12 a year through the Patreon would be excellent. Or if you want to do a one-time contribution, you can do it through PayPal or a credit card at hamradionow.tv. So see Arvin's icon there at the bottom of the page. And that's the business. I can do business because we're not on the air.
That's right. We're not. We're not actually doing amateur radio.
Not on the ham radio air. I like to say we are on the air. Ham Radio Now is on the air. I went through this with Leo Laporte early in the iteration of Ham Nation. Because, you know, technically we're not on the air, but we're going through people's Wi-Fis. That's radio. So we're on the air. So, Jeff, you're on the air.
All right.
And welcome, Jeff.
Thank you.
David, kick us off. Ask the right questions here.
Okay. So, you know, the article there said you kind of get started on all this doing national parks on the air. So why don't we start with that? Tell us about, you know, how you got into national parks on the air and what your experiences were like this year or last year participating in that.
Well, if I may be so bold as to speak about another program, I won't mention them directly by name, but I heard Stuart Thomas, who ended up being the leader, the number one activator at the end of the year in the program on another podcast.
You can mention the name of the podcast. That's okay.
Okay, very good. Okay, so at the time it was the FOTIME podcast, but I guess they have now changed their name to the Ham Radio 360 podcast. So,
because all the good names were taken, so it was kind of stuck with that.
So I heard Stuart being interviewed in February of last year about his participation in NPOTA, and thought, wow, you know, he is local to the DC area, as am I, and I thought if I were ever able to get the capability of having an HF rig in my car, what a great way for me to be able to get out of the house. My personal situation is that I suffer from chronic illness and have since 2010, and it keeps me from doing pretty much most activities, even my worship, you know, just a lot of things in general. I'm confined to my home. But I thought, you know, here's something. I took a look after hearing about the program. I looked, and I believe offhand it was 26 or 28 sites that were within an hour and a half drive of Rockville, Maryland, where I live. And I thought, you know, this would be low hanging fruit, so to speak, where most of these activations I could do right from the comfort of my car or right nearby the car.
Yeah, you're right, right outside of Washington, D.C., right?
That's correct.
Yeah. So, I mean, the federal government's got tons of national park stuff up there.
That's correct.
I looked for it around here in North Carolina to see what I might be able to do, and there's just nothing anywhere nearby. Got to go out to the Smoky Mountains, 5 hours away to find a national park.
Yeah, and that was one of the advantages I had is once I started to participate, I found myself at the end of July, a club member put one of their rigs up for sale for a very good price and was nice enough to give me terms on it where I was able to make payments. And the day after he gave me the rig, I made my first activation and suddenly found myself receiving emails from people all over the country saying, hey, do you have plans on activating this park or this one? And just because of the uniqueness of where I was located geographically, I found myself being able to be in a position to help a lot of people. And my prior service was in law enforcement. I was a three-time police chief in the state of Maryland and also a federal government contractor. I had just a lot of public safety, a lot of public service experience. So I really love to help and serve people. And this gave me, you know, that, and that's why I got into ham radio also, is just that that community was very appealing to me. It was an extension of my personal values. So I found that same mindset was there expressed in National Parks on the Air, and it gave me an outlet not only to give back to that community, but it gave me an avenue to, again, become engaged in the world. And I found a very strong Facebook presence, you know, the social media. There was this whole world right there that it was almost like family, being able to reach out to these folks. There was a fellow activator who was traveling across Michigan, or from across the country from Michigan, Laura S., who came into the area when she said she was going to travel into Washington. She saw that we were doing an activation with my club and said, you know, hey, Jeff, I'd like to do an eyeball with you. And so I met up with her. I met, of course, Stuart, and thanked him for getting me involved in the program. I met another activator, Whiskey 3 Uniform Charlie, Jamie Ashton, out on the Eastern Shore of Maryland. Just made several very close relationships with people through the program. And it's just an experience that I'll never forget.
So Jeff, how many activations did you, were you able to do? How many different locations and how many contacts did you make? You have an idea?
I believe when everything shook out, I made 64 separate activations, and I think it was 38 unique units. So not, you know, I didn't set the world on fire, so to speak, mm-hmm. but considering my first activation was July 28th, and I also am not a paper chaser, so to speak, I didn't specifically set out to do every activation under my call sign. You know, there were several places that I went where I did an activation under the club's call sign, never activated under my own call sign. So I know that there were other activations that I did in addition to the ones that were officially on the books under my call sign, or activations that I assisted other activators and just used their call sign and not my own.
So you were there more for just having fun.
Yeah. And also, like I said, to get out of the house, and just also my intention was, I continued to say it all along as often as I could and as loud as I could. My intention was to get these quote unquote rare ones into the logs of the people that needed them. It seemed that for whatever reason, either geographically or just because of conditions or security measures or whatever the case may be, people were having difficulty logging these Washington area parks in their logs. And I just ended up becoming one of a handful of people that was uniquely placed to be able to help people get these parks in their logs. So
did you need to use your contacts with having been a police chief and having been a government contractor? Did those help get you into places other people couldn't get into, or did you just know how to do it?
No, I think it helped. I'll give you an example. Ford's Theater was one that had only been activated a handful of times. And again, with my mobility issues and things, now many of my activations, I only did, I would call them impromptu activations. I wouldn't say like in 3 days, I'm going to go activate park number XYZ. I would just be in an area, and if I had the time and felt up to it and had a couple hours on my hands, I would say, okay, let's activate. And, or there was parking nearby. Parking was always a consideration because I can only walk a couple hundred feet without the use of a wheelchair. So, one night after helping my friend Jamie, who I spoke of earlier, activate in DC, I rode by Ford's Theater just to get the lay of the land, to see what it would take to activate there. And lo and behold, there was a parking space right out front. And I thought, ah, I guess it's meant to be. So I parked right out front, unloaded my equipment, and started setting up on the sidewalk, and pulled on the doors. The place looked obviously closed. There was only just a couple people inside. One of them was a uniformed security officer who didn't seem to be paying any attention to me. So I set up as what we call a stoop activation, just right there in the front, right by the doorway, but clear of the door so that they'd be able to open the doors and not be, obstructing anything. So, once I get everything set up and start making the first couple of contacts, now the uniformed security officer decides to come out and engage me. And so I ask everybody to stand by, and the officer says to me, are you sure you're supposed to be here? Now, I think most people would have been intimidated by that. And I said, well, I don't know why not. I'm in a public area. I'm operating my amateur radio equipment. I have a license to do so. There's nothing to prohibit me from doing this. I'm engaged in lawful activity. And he says, well, are you sure? Because I'm about to make a call and I just want to make sure you're not going to get in trouble. And I said, well, you call whoever you'd like to call. So he says, okay. So off he goes inside. And after a couple minutes, a U.S. Park police cruiser pulls up and they come out and they come up and speak with me. And again, I ask people to stand by and say, can I help you, officer? And they said, well, we got a call saying that you were disorderly and you refused to move on when requested to do so by the security officer. And I said, no, that's not the case at all. And I explained my background and who I was and what I was doing, and gave the officer a copy of my license, my amateur radio license. And I gave them a copy of the National Parks on the Air information sheet that was put out by the ARRL. And the officer said, well, let me go in and speak with the security officer. So the police officer comes back out and says, well, our only concern is that there's a 600-seat play going on inside right now. Now, who would have thought, with a parking spot immediately available to me right out front? And again, I looked in, the doors were locked when I walked up. There was no appearance whatsoever that there was an active play happening inside. And I thought, oh my goodness, of course the security officer would be concerned that here I am with a wheelchair full of equipment and a buddy pole set up and a radial strung out along the sidewalk. If they're going to have 600 people coming out of the building, of course, I would have concerns about that too. And I said, officer, I had no idea that there was any kind of an event happening here. That would have been something that would have been potentially useful for the officer to have told me about. And I said, well, how about we do this? When the people are getting ready to come out, how about that officer give me a thumbs up and, like a 5-minute warning, so to speak. I'll pull in the radial antenna. I told the officer how the antenna works and why that wire was necessary for the operation of the radio. I said, I'll pull that wire in. I'll confine my footprint of the operating space to a very small area just for those few minutes, let everybody go on their way. And after about 15 minutes or so, after everybody clears out, I'll start my operation again. And he says, that sounds like a fine idea. Gave me my everything back. And after a few minutes, that's exactly what happened. The play got let out. Everyone went on their way, and it was a fine and successful operation. So it was just an example of how my experience and knowing how to deal with uniformed officers and how the procedures work really was beneficial, in line with how to activate with National Parks on the Air. It was one of many times that it was useful.
Yeah, the ARRL pamphlet that they put out, I used a couple times. I did a couple activations myself, and it was very easy to go talk to the person that was taking money at the parking lot or the ranger that was doing patrol and say, hey, just so you know, I'm going to do this now, and here's a pamphlet about it. And if you have any questions or you want to come join me, that's great. And I never encountered any challenges at all. But mostly I was in, you know, national forests and parks and parking lots and such.
I've been trying to pull up the picture of the buddy pole so people could get an idea what looks like. And every time I try, I end up with something that I'm not looking for. That's what it looks like. It could be what, 10, 20 feet across.
Yeah. I actually had I have both the buddy pole and the buddy stick. So that evening I was using the buddy stick. So I was using the vertical buddy stick. Yes.
Yeah. And that has no horizontal footprint at all.
Right.
Yeah. Not at all.
But other than the radial.
Mm. Okay. So what kind of radio were you using? You said you got a used one from somebody in your club.
Yeah. An FT-857 Delta. Was great because at home I used the 897. So it was very intuitive to me. A lot of the same menus and everything else and the same accessories. So it was just like peanut butter and jelly. It was just great.
And a portable battery and off you roll.
Absolutely.
Great. Great. So, so tell us a little bit about the big opportunity you had that turned into something big and exciting for, the presidential inauguration. How did that all come together?
So similar to many of the other activators, I think we were all planning what's going to be the big finale during the last week. How are we going to exit this year long event? And what are we going to do to kind of give the tip of the hat? And, we decided, as a club and, just kind of the few of us that were really active in the club, and then also Jamie and I decided together that we were going to activate the Sewell Belmont House. We wanted that to be our final activation, and that we were going to run there all the way up until midnight UTC, and that was going to require the use of a permit. So I went down to the headquarters of the National Mall Memorial Parks. And while I was down there to obtain the permit, a gentleman comes out in a ranger uniform to just, you know, say hi and, you know, welcome. And I had no idea that I was speaking to the chief of staff of the parks there. But that came out in subsequent conversation, and just in my chatting with him, I told him of my background. And so we exchanged business cards, and I always as a habit, whenever I meet someone like that, I think it's a good idea to send an email later on. And so I did that and said, you know, chief, I wanted to thank you for your professionalism. And I also wanted to thank you again for the professionalism of your staff. I've had the opportunity to activate, you know, from every one of the units that fall under your command and control down here on the mall, and have found your staff to be, you know, most excellent, and, you know, things in that vein. So maybe for the
one guy at Forge Theater who kind of went a little more ballistic than he should have.
I didn't quite hear what you say. The audio cut off. I'm sorry.
I was saying that one guy you ran into at Forge Theater who was, you know, just a little bit more hair on fire than he ought to be.
Well, he was a contract security employee, you know, in all fairness. But in any regard, I've had tremendous respect and professionalism shown to me throughout the activations. They've just been incredible, just how I've been treated just throughout. I remember, just as a side note, the Vietnam Veterans Memorial, the ranger there, Bob, came out of the booth where they do the cancellations of your passport, and was very interested in what I was doing, asked me all about ham radio and made sure I was okay. You know, he saw me with my wheelchair and was making sure that I was getting set up okay, and just really went above and beyond the call of duty to make sure that I was set up okay. And I mentioned Bob in my email to the chief there, and in any event. So I think it was a result of that email and them having on record that I was an amateur radio operator. I had also, just by For courtesy, I sent a copy of that over to Sean and Norm at the ARRL just to let them know for their purposes, hey, this is the kind of networking we're doing, you know, for and through National Parks on the Air. So a couple of weeks later, I get an email from the volunteer coordinator at the National Park Service, an email that was addressed to me, Sean, and Norm saying, I understand you three gentlemen are amateur radio operators, and would you be interested in participating in our inaugural event? So I took the liberty of speaking for the three of us and saying, well, Sean and Norm are in Newington, Connecticut, so I think it might be a stretch for them to operate. However, I'm in Rockville, and I would absolutely be interested, and here are my qualifications. And
Sean, I know is Sean Kutzko, KX9X, is that his call?
I don't know what it is offhand, but right, yeah.
Sean is their media PR guy, and this whole National Parks on the Air was his brainstorm. Following the previous year's centennial operation, he was looking for something to follow that up, and because the centennial operation just caught fire, you know, people madly dashing after working all of the centennial stations, and he was looking for something that would actually tack on to that, maybe involve more people who could go out and play, because the centennial stations were limited. And so the national parks were having last year their centennial. And so I thought, well, everybody can participate. They can go to the parks and get on the air. And that's what you were doing. So we'll give kudos to ARRL and to Sean for creating that. And I'm not sure who Norm is.
Norm, I believe a Bizarro is how you pronounce his last name, but he's also in the ARRL. I believe I don't know for sure, but I believe Sean may either report to or work, but he works closely with Sean at the ARRL, because they're both, I know they're both involved with the National Parks on the Air program, because I saw both of their names quite a bit on the National Parks on the Air Facebook page. And everybody that commented on the program would always say, thank you, Sean and Norm, for all of your hard work on this program. So I don't want to speak out of turn, because I don't know all of the political structure there, but I do know that both of them were heavily involved in the program.
Yeah.
So, but
another phenomenal success. So we're little bit,
that was a great program.
We're a little bit burying the lead, because we're where you're headed with the story, and I'll let you carry on with the story in a moment, but you were involved in ham radio communications, helping the National Park Service during the inaugural, where there were lots and lots of people flooding into DC. So that's where you're going. And I'm kind of afraid it was going to take a while to get there and people understand what we're talking about. So now they have contacted you to help out and continue with the story, and we'll find out what.
Yeah. So they asked me to volunteer with the inaugural events and serve as a communications officer at the incident command post down at the National Park Service headquarters in Washington, D.C. So during all 3 days of the inauguration. So I received the initial email on Tuesday. I gave my qualifications over to them and a return email on Tuesday evening, had a phone conversation on Wednesday for all the vetting process. And on Thursday morning, I was sitting in a chair serving. So that's how quickly everything came together. And then I don't know if you want me to get into this portion of it yet, but as a side note, and it was a very fortuitous congruence of events, but while I was serving on Friday, I received a call from Art Feller, W4ART, who was serving in a public service capacity with the folks that were coordinating the Women's March on Washington. And they were looking for a club space to utilize as the net control station for the public service amateur radio operators that were going to be serving on day 3 of the inaugural events.
Yeah. So that was happening the next day. And
the very next day.
So yeah. let's stick with the inauguration for a little bit. Okay. And so we're not just the audience. I want to understand, we are not trying to be political about it. The inauguration was a one thing on one day. I guess that was a Thursday or Tuesday.
It was Thursday, Friday, and Saturday.
Okay.
It was a 3-day event. And then the third day also had a permitted, one of over 90 permitted events was the Women's March on Washington.
Yeah. And that was a protest event. So, and Ham Radio was involved in both. But before we get deep into the part two, I want to know what you did and how you did it and what, you know, it wasn't all Ham Radio, but it was some Ham Radio, right?
Yeah, that's the question I have is what was the capacity? What did you do? What kind of equipment did you use? And who did you work with?
Tell us stories.
Yeah.
Well, exactly. Basically, my role was as communications officer. I monitored several of the internal National Park Service frequencies. They had several of their internal nets working for their personnel, basically their rangers and their command staff, on their operational channels. And I also help them with their equipment issues, basically issuing radios and batteries, lapel mics, radio clips, things like that, as their rangers went in and out of the field. I would say several hundred people. I don't know exactly how many, but it was quite a few that came in all day, all afternoon. And yeah, so I've worked 32 hours in 3 days. So yeah, it was, that was pretty much the long and the short of it, was monitoring 4 different nets and issuing the equipment simultaneously. I worked with 3 other folks, 1 other volunteer, 2 other communications officers that were direct employees of the Park Service. And the other employee came from the Civil Air Patrol.
What was the Park Service responsible for doing? Because I mean, there were security agencies and police departments and, you know, federal agencies galore, I'm sure, and everyone had a different set of responsibilities. What was the Park Service's job?
The primary agency responsible for security was the Secret Service. So the Park Service was responsible, of course, for the protection of their grounds and the people that were on there, basically. So,
and that's like the National Mall is, that's Park Service. All of the monuments.
All of the monuments, any Park Service grounds, basically the people and property that are within DC that fall under the command of the National Park Service, which is quite a bit of property. People don't realize just how much land falls under the Park Service. And the really interesting thing for me and my involvement with this was that I had just operated from every single entity just less than 2 weeks before I finished up my service with National Parks on the Air. So I was intimately familiar with every park unit. So when they said to me things like, the crowd has left and they've moved from the FDR Memorial, moving past MLK, and are moving towards the Lincoln Memorial, I knew that they would have to cross over the Korean War Memorial to get en route that way, because, you know, I had that in my mind because I had already operated from those positions just in the last couple of weeks. So I had area familiarization specifically from my involvement with National Parks on the Air. So there was a lot of things that came together that just made it the perfect, like I said, congruence of events to make it all just come together.
Was the Park Service doing crowd control? On their grounds?
They do crowd control to the extent where they set up the barricades and they encourage people to move in certain ways. And they also have the park police. There was a park police officer represented at the command center at the National Park Service, but they have their own dispatch center as well. So There were several different command centers in the city that were operational all at the same time. Of course, the Metropolitan Police Department has their command center, Secret Service, but the National Park Service having their own command center, I was a part of their command center.
Was this all put together under the formal incident command structure, or being the federal government, could they ignore that and do what they wanted?
No, there was, it was all under the ICS command structure. There was an actual plan that was written up. Everything was all spelled out. Who was the incident commander, everyone's roles, everything down to the frequencies that were used, how they were used, who would use them, and why. It was all spelled out in the incident command plan. It was there was even a time, and again, I don't know all of the form names as it relates back over to amateur radio, because I'm a fairly new ham. I became a ham in 2013 and then had to take a break in 2015 because of my illness. But in traffic handling nets, there's a form that's used when you pass on the messages. In the incident command structure, there's that similar form that's used when somebody needs to pass a message on and they need to get it on the air. We use that exact same form. The Sergeant
ICS 213.
There you go. yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much. So there was a form that was that form we used that day. The sergeant came over from the Park Police Command Center, the incident command post, and came over to me and said, "We need to get this message on the air right away." And I said, "Okay, Sergeant, what do you want to say?" And I was able to grab the form and write it all out and get it to her liking and get her to approve it and get her to sign off on it. I signed off on it. The communications supervisor signed off on it, and verbatim, based on what she wanted to say, I was able to communicate it and then log it in, you know, putting it down as that was the message that was communicated at this time. So yes, it all involved the incident command structure.
That's great. And then from my perspective, that's real EmComm. I mean, it wasn't really an emergency per se, but you know, I'm an Aries EC, and you know, we go and work with whoever we need to in the event of emergency in the ICS structure. And game again, there's the forms that they need to use and the approval process, and sometimes we have to use our equipment and sometimes we use their equipment. But it sounded like, you know, they needed you, they put you in a place, you stepped up and performed the service that you could and followed all the rules, and I think that's really great.
Was most of the communications and radio stuff that you were using on the federal frequencies, was yes, there much ham radio at all?
There was some ham radio that took place just in my monitoring what was happening with W3HAC's command center and day three, their activity and how they were utilizing my club space and running their operations. So there was, again, sort of another story behind the story, in that I had been the newly elected president of this club that just happened to be now utilized as the public service space for the hams that were assisting this public service event for the Women's March on Washington. And again, it didn't matter so much what the event was. It didn't matter if it would be a rally, a parade, a picnic. You know, it doesn't matter that it was a political event. The point was, you know, when you have 600,000 plus people estimated to come to the city, and it was about 20 hams that served that day, and these folks came in and stepped up and served. There were some really interesting things that came out of day three, and how they stepped in and performed, and some of the things that they did where Park Service personnel nor law enforcement personnel were immediately available to come in and help immediately in the situation. They did more than just observe and report in certain circumstances. Not that we would encourage or say, you know, these are law enforcement folks per se, but if I may cite an example, on day three, there were some of the ham radio operators that were marching with the volunteer marshals and other volunteers for the march. And just because of the size of the crowd, they got into certain areas where some perimeter fencing had become breached, and the crowd spilled into some unauthorized areas that people were not supposed to go. These marshals and ham radio operators, just while they did call utilizing their they used their net control station and asked for assistance to call us at the National Park Service. I heard it directly, but then they called for assistance and asked for law enforcement and National Park Service officers to respond. They themselves were able to convince people to leave the area voluntarily. They said, you know, folks, hey, you're not supposed to be in this area. Please step out of this area. So for them to be able to do things like that was just amazing, where they, again, less than 20 people were able to ask thousands and thousands of people to voluntarily move out of certain areas, I think was just incredible. Also, there was a point where the crowd was so thick in certain areas that the Park Service asked me to communicate to W3HAC that the Park Service was telling their folks that if law enforcement and medical personnel were to go in certain areas, that there was a chance that they may not be able to get out very quickly due to the crowd size. And just to be aware for their own safety, they specified certain geographic areas. So we passed that information on over to the command center at W3HAC. Well, the response came back, well, what can we do to help? So I put Gary Shipley, the communications supervisor, on the phone with Art Feller and said, what was the recommendation? What can they do? And Gary's response was, well, if there's any way that the folks there can encourage the crowd to perhaps spread out, find open areas, try to find a way to thin out a little bit, if they're able to do that, that would be helpful. And they were able to get that message passed out and through the crowds, and it was effective. So they did more than just your classic observe and report. And those were the types of things that we were able to do, I think, very effectively, because we had this connection between the two command centers that just didn't exist classically between most command centers. And it just happened, you know, with you know, one day before the event, it just happened to come together like that. And again, the whole incident for the Women's March on Washington was planned with less than a week of, with less than a week of planning. Yeah. So kudos to them for getting it all together. I think they did a fantastic job.
So let me take one step back.
Sure.
And just wrap up with the inauguration itself. There was no formal ham radio activity at the inauguration. Hams were not posted anywhere. There's so many federal officers and DC officers. They handled all their own stuff. And you were just participating in that.
Correct.
So if the Women's March had probably a major police and security component of folks monitoring what they were doing, but they needed their own communications and coordination that was not going to be government in any way. Right. And that's what they reached out to Ham Radio to assist with. This is the first I became aware that Ham Radio would have a component in it, because I wasn't expecting it. And I saw this comment on Reddit. KC3CIF, Christine. Do you know Christine?
Yes, Christine's the previous president of the HacDC Amateur Radio Club.
Yep. So she put this notice on Reddit and just said, Women's March on Washington, January 21st, need ham radio operators. It wasn't very specific. She did say you would need a VHF-UHF handheld radio, backup power to last 24 hours, private message me on the listserv. She was just reaching out to Reddit hams and her call sign. And I was thinking, oh my God, here we go. Because we are staying ecumenical about the politics involved, but it was on the inauguration, you know, very happily one side and the other side not real happy. The Women's March flipped that equation. One side very happy, the other side not very happy. And I'm thinking, wow, ham radio is going to be stepping on a real landmine here to get involved in something like this. And again, with this notice, it didn't include anything about the radio club. So I wasn't aware until we started talking to you and I saw the announcement on the ARRL's website that, that the radio club was going to be involved, which of course is the way to do it. So if you look through the rest of the comments, they've locked it because it was going to go on forever. And, you know, it's got 89 comments in there. Some of them do trod on that territory from one side or the other. You know, people just have to get their political rant in. But most of those comments don't. A lot of them were saying, well, how could ham radio help with something like this? Or, you know, what are the procedures and, you know, what's the legality and all that stuff? So you weren't directly involved with the Women's March stuff. Were you still working at the National Park Service headquarters, communications, on that day as well? Sounds like that's what you were doing.
Yes, I was. I personally was on day three at the Park Service on day three. Yes. And again, the March folks were initially going to use space out of the Armed Forces Retirement Home, and that fell through at the last minute. So that's why they contacted us the day before the march and said, we're looking for some space. Do you mind if we use your club space? So it was interesting. And again, I think this transcends more than, you know, you have people that were helping to assist with the plans. Well, let me take a step back. When you apply for a permit with the Park Service says, okay, if you have a large crowd, tell us what you're going to do to assist with these extra crowds. What type of first aid capabilities are you going to bring to bear? What kind of crowd control efforts are you going to bring to bear? How will your folks communicate with one another? These are types of things that you have to fill out on your permit application. So the ham radio piece came into their planning very late. And I say late because their entire efforts to plan their entire event took less than a week. But in their overall planning efforts of their event, it was only in the last couple of days that ham radio come into it, and how they would communicate between their coordinators and people in the field, let's say, versus just using cell phones or text messaging. They, I believe, were under the assumption that, oh, well, we can just use Twitter, or we could use these other types of things. And I believe it was Art that gave them the more realistic understanding that when you bring so many people together in such a small space, that those types of communications, things are probably going to fail and ended up failing. So they might need to have amateur radio available to them. But that all being said, there is also the regular public service component that you would have in an event. And the thing that I would liken it to would be the Marine Corps Marathon, because that is something that does happen in this area. That is something that ART is involved with quite often. And it was the Marine Corps Marathon's sort of base plan that he used to utilize and put over the operations that took place in the Women's March on Washington on how hams would just give general oversight and support of so many people walking around in so many square miles. And it doesn't matter what they're there for. It could be, again, they could be there for any type of parade, rally, marathon. It doesn't really matter what they're there to do. The point is that we as amateur radio operators are there to step in and fill a need where traditional public safety resources become overwhelmed or communications lines go down. We are available and can step up and fill those roles or fill those needs. And I think that's really a story that needs to be told, because that happened here.
Mm-hmm. Jeff, when they originally reached out to you to ask you to participate in the inauguration, did they tell you how many days had they originally planned to go? I guess you said you were there for 3 days. Did you originally plan to go for all 3 days, or was it just for the initial, swearing in events? And the over time, as they saw this women's march grow, did they add on extra time that they wanted you to stay and participate, or were there other inauguration activities going on at the same time on that Saturday when they had the march?
It was a 3-day activity. There was a formal schedule of events that occurred over 3 days, and then there were over 90 permitted events that took place during that same time period. And then, you know, if you think of all the conflicting political views and all of the people that are going to show up that are not going to have a permit or are going to be supportive of one side or another and encouraging those people that have permits, a lot was happening in a very small space, all kind of coming together at one time. So that was the need for folks, and that was all part of the call out for help.
So I think we are going to try to get Art to join us, David, for a show, and we'll go into more depth on the actual communications that he's familiar with. And I tossed a message to Christine. Maybe she can join us too. She's got some YouTube videos. She's very personable on camera, so she should be happy about doing that. So we'll see. We can do another show and get deeper into the weeds on doing that. Just how it worked out. But it sounds like the political considerations just didn't really intrude on the ham radio operation. People didn't, I mean, we have heard in the general media, it's, you know, just so spun up on both sides. Everyone seems to have gone totally to the wall on one side and the other, that I'm almost surprised that anyone could just do their job in the middle, but it sounds like that's what the hams did.
Yeah. From my understanding, from the things I've heard from the quote unquote, as I'm liking to call them, the boots on the ground, the amateur radio operators that were walking in and amongst the crowd did a phenomenal job and again, I'm not saying that people should try to play, you know, law enforcement officer or try to step in roles that are over and above their training. We shouldn't try to encourage things like that. People should do the classic observe and report. But to the extent of the reports that I'm getting back and for the reasons why people did what they did and how they did, I think people did a phenomenal job. And I think that any one of us would have done the same things that people did. I think, there's a standard. Again, I was a three-time chief of police, and there's a standard that police officers are held to in the performance of their duties. And it's called the reasonable officer standard. And it's basically if another officer were put in a similar circumstance and would have responded in a similar way, then that is considered to have been a reasonable action. And I think any one of us, had we been put in a similar role as these people were, I think we would have responded in similar ways. And I think that they all did phenomenal jobs, considering the enormous amount of stress that they were under, with how many people were around them. And I think that that's these are the stories behind the stories that I think we as amateur radio operators know the value that we bring to the general community, but I just don't think that the general community understands just how valuable the amateur radio service is to them and how much we do to keep them safe in times of crisis or in times of enhanced public service need.
That's really great. And I really do want to follow up with Art and I don't remember the woman's name or her call sign.
Christine.
Yeah, Christine, to really get the story of the folks on the ground. And I think that's really great what they did.
Yeah, I've just got a Reddit contact and not an email. So
I can help you folks out with that offline.
All right.
Okay, great.
I would like to leave something a little less vague. I think you mentioned what the hams did that went a little above and beyond communications, maybe a lot above and beyond communications, in terms of crowd control. It was basically getting the instructions to say, can you see if you can get these people to get out of this place they're not supposed to be and go over to this place where it's okay? Do I have that right, or was there more to it?
Oh, basically, that was it. There was a call put into us that some perimeter fencing had gone down in several areas, and people had spilled into an area. It was nothing malicious. It wasn't that people were, we're going to tear down this fencing. It was just the mass of people just tore down the fencing. And a call came in through the net control center that was immediately heard by me because I was monitoring the W3HAC frequencies. But nonetheless, the call still came over across the channels to us at the National Park Service Incident Command Post. So we called for the Park Service personnel, and while they were waiting for folks to respond, the volunteers and hams were convincing folks to get out of that area, that was an unauthorized area, and were persuasive in getting them to leave that area. And yeah, just
a little bull by the horns action. David, yeah. It takes a while to get logistics moving and get people from one place to another. And I'm sure you run into this all the time. People don't realize that you don't get instant response out there in the world.
Yeah. And, we work events like this. So, I work a number of races every year. A lot of the guys that I work with work the LA Marathon. We work the Baker to Vegas race. We work the Angeles Crest 100 race and just a number of other things. And it is a big logistic event to get there and get set up and get the nets up and running and then make sure that, those participants are going the right way and doing the right things. It is a massive undertaking. I can't imagine, 600 or 750,000 people in that space and being able to, herd the cats, as it were, move them in the right direction. The scale that we do it on is much smaller, and sometimes it's still challenging. And I'm really glad that, amateur radio could play a good part in making a solution, providing security and backup for everyone there.
One of my big example stories, and this is a very small scale, is one of the bike tours that I do, one of the bike MS tours. And for years and years and years, there was always this call that went over the ham radio channels. We need to get move some cups or some water or fruit from rest stop 3 to rest stop 5, because rest stop 3 is closing and rest stop 5 is got a lot of people coming in and they need more stuff. And it took a long time to finally convince everybody that that's not going to happen. It'll be 45 minutes to get stuff from one place to another. And in 45 minutes, the crowd is gone at rest stop 5. So they finally try to just sort of figure it out that the logistics just don't happen instantly. The radio message can go instantly, but
right.
But the people and the actual effort behind it, that's not going to be that fast. So it sounds like the hams just said, there's nobody showing up to do this. We can do it now. Let's do it.
Yeah, and I've experienced that as well. We do a lot of drills and a lot of training with different organizations. And I can tell you a number of times where we've been on the ground at a location or another, and there's something to set up or something to put together, and a bunch of folks that's not their primary function need to do and don't quite understand or have the concept how to do it. And, you know, hams were resilient, we're smart, we're builders and makers. And, you know, time and time again, you know, myself and some of the other leaders in our organization will step in and say, hey, can, you know, it's not observe and report, but it's, hey, can we step in and help you figure out how to blow that tent up or put that thing up or take that thing down? And we do it all the time because we're there and, you know, we have that good heart of the volunteer and want to help.
Yeah. As long as it doesn't preclude doing the communications job.
Yeah.
That's job.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yep. Yep.
So I don't know if we'll be able to do a part two. I hope we can. I did two parts back during the Boston Marathon. I talked to people in two different areas when the Boston Marathon bombing had happened. And there was a lot of ham radio participation in that. Obviously, ham radio is there for the marathon every year. With logistics. And then when the bombing happened, well, everyone, you know, all plans failed to survive contact with the enemy, except they didn't. Everything kept working, and the hams got very involved. So that was a two-parter. Maybe we can dig into more details that you don't have, Jeff, because you were at the Park Service headquarters. So we can get Art and maybe Christine. Christine, are you watching? Did anybody make you tune in? I don't know. Yeah, go ahead. Oh, that was me. I think I'm echoing back from somebody's speaker. But Jeff, is there anything else that has been floating around your brain that you want to make sure we understand about how this all worked?
It was just an amazing opportunity, and I'm just grateful to have been given the chance to serve. It was just an honor and a privilege, and I just really want to thank you for the invitation to, again, get the message out and just have any avenue to share just how important amateur radio is to the community, and thank you very much.
These are the reason why I started the EmComm Extra from Ham Radio Now is I got tired of reading the dry after action reports that would be printed 6 months, 9 months, a year and a half after something happened in QST. And I wanted to get real stories from people who were there. And that's what this is. So if you're out there watching this and you've got a real story, contact David at W0DHGARRL.net. And we'll see if we can get you in to tell a story like this. Because the hams that are interested in participating with the EmComm, or the hams that would be interested but haven't stuck their toe in it yet, they need to know that other people are doing it and get some of the reality of how it's actually working. Some of the, you know, what I say is, you know, get the stories out of the weeds.
Yeah.
Let people know it really happened. Well, Jeff, congratulations on that participation. Do you think that anything else will come of that? Is there any follow on?
I hope so. I was told that if there's a future need for personnel, that I will be their first call. So knock on wood, I hope, God willing, that happens again. And again, it would be an honor and privilege to serve. So the reason I do this is I love to help and serve people, so hopefully there will be additional opportunities.
Yeah, and I hope you feel well enough to be able to do all that, because, you know,
thank you so much.
It's been really rough. I guess this will be a more appropriate question to talk to Art and Christine about, but how did the Women's March leaders and organizers. I think you sort of think of the women's march as being this amorphous mass of people without much coordination, but apparently there was a lot of coordination. How did the folks who were leading that, as last moment as it was, make a connection with ham radio?
Yeah, and that I don't know exactly how it came together. So it's probably a question best given that it's my understanding that Art saw something about it online and reached out to them. But again, I don't know directly how it happened. So probably a question best left for Art W4ART.
Okay. Art, Christine, we want you on Ham Radio Now. Your hams want you.
Absolutely. And Jeff, I just want to say thank you so much for painting amateur radio in a good light. You know, you stepped in with the public service folks and, you know, you're professional and you had the right attitude. And that's one of the things we talk about in our areas group over and over again. You know, you're there to help. You're not in charge. You're there to provide a service and you did an awesome job. And thank you for your service.
Oh, thank you. I really appreciate it. Again, it was an honor and a privilege. Thank you so much.
So, David, well, first of all, I will mention once again the fundraising. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. If you enjoy the programs, get something out of them, can help us out. It does cost a little bit. Arvin's sitting back there. And he is our chief financial officer. So stop by hamradionow.tv. It's our website. And you can make a contribution. They've been more than trickling in. You know, I'm not set up for life here, you know, with a solid retirement. I'm very happy to be getting Social Security now. It helps a lot, but it helps maintain the equipment. This stuff is constantly falling apart, and get me out on the road a little bit. I'll be wrapping up this stuff when we finish this show and getting ready to head down to Orlando and helping out with Jason Johnson, KC5HWB, and his ham radio 2.0, I'm looking forward to that. It's the first time I've collaborated. I've offered collaboration to a bunch of other people, and they've all gone, yeah, ham radio now. You guys are too opinionated. but Jason likes us, so we'll be playing with Jason. David, we need to include Jeff in the sign-off. Maybe we need to send instructions in advance, but I don't mind doing this. I don't mind doing this on the fly. I think people enjoy it. But I'll let you give the instructions here. I did it last time.
All right. So at the end of all of our shows, Jeff, we go into very poor radio operating procedure. And so we're going to all introduce ourselves, and we're going to close by each one of us is going to say one of the words of over and out. So I'll be over. Jeff, you be and Gary will be out. So let's first introduce ourselves. So you want to start, Gary?
I am Gary Pearce, KN4AQ, the host, editor, producer, and occasionally I sweep the floors here at Ham Radio Now.
And Jeff?
I'm Jeff Dahn, KB3ZUK, president of the HacDC Amateur Radio Club.
And I'm David, W0DHG, a co-host of the Ham Radio Now podcast. Over.
That's your cue, Jeff. You say and.
Oh, I already said and. I'm sorry.
Okay. We have to do it again. It's just like soft kitty. You can't.
I thought you wanted me to say and after.
after I say over. Okay.
We need David as an instructional video.
I'm going to get little cards to hold out. So here we're going to go one more time. Over.
And.
Out. See, excellent. It's not that hard.
It wasn't so bad.